أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. الحمد لله والحمد لله إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره. In the name of Allah, most gracious, most merciful, we seek refuge with Allah from the curse of Satan. In the name of Allah, most gracious, most merciful, Master of the Day of Judgment, He who has power over all things. He created all that is, and all that exists depends upon Him and Him alone. We bear witness that there is no God except He, Allah Almighty, and we bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is His servant and His messenger and the seal of all of the prophets, the last of all the prophets to come. Amma ba'd. Assalamu alaikum. Ya ikhwati wa akhwati, wajadna anfusana fil harb. وهذه الحرب حرب لقلوب وعقول. وبلا شك عندنا سلاح الخير لفلاحي في هذه الحرب. للفلاحي يجب أن يحاص سلاحنا بأعدائنا. يكون أعدائنا الجاهلون والغافلون، ويكون سلاحنا الحق. أمر الله أن نخذوا الحق إلى الناس. هذه مصليتنا، وهذه مصليتنا مصلية أكرمة المأمورية مأموريات. عندما نتخذ هذه المأموريات، هذه نعمة كبيرة علينا، لأن فيها سهل الله لنا طريقا إلى الجنة. لنفعل هذه الدعوة، هذه الدعوة في سبيل الله، يجب أن ندرس هدايا الله. قال الله تعالى في القرآن الكريم بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم: الذين آتيناهم الكتاب يتلونه حق تلاوته أولئك يؤمنون به، ومن يكفر به فأولئك هم الخاسرون. وقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم: خير منكم من تعلم القرآن وعلمه. بهذا طريق نأجل رحمة الله. Well, my brothers and sisters, we find ourselves in a war. And this war is a war for hearts and minds. And without a doubt, we have the best weapon for this war. for success in this war. What we have to do is share our weapon with our enemies. It's a strange thing, isn't it? All we need to do for success is share our weapon with our enemies. You see, our enemies are those who are ignorant and heedless. They are those who do not know the truth. And our weapon for this war is simply the truth. And Allah commands that we take the truth to mankind. This is our mission. And this mission of ours is the most noble of all missions. And when we take on this mission, this is a big and enormous blessing for us, for whoever chooses to take on this mission. Because in it, in the carrying out of this mission, Allah makes easy for us the path to paradise. The path to heaven is made easy for us. For us to do this da'wah, this inviting to the way of Allah, or inviting to the truth in the way of Allah, it's necessary that we study Allah's guidance. And Allah Almighty has told us in His book, in translation, those to whom we have given the book, they study it and follow it as it should be studied and followed. These are the ones who believe in it. And whoever rejects it, they are the losers. And our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the seal of the prophets, shared this with us when he said, "The best of you is he who learns the Quran and teaches it." And in this, brothers and sisters, in this path, comes the mercy of Allah. And surely the mercy of Allah is a great achievement. I share these thoughts with you today to point out to you that we are in a war. And again, I remind you that this war is a war for hearts and minds. You know, it's interesting, I noticed that this expression is used by the enemies of Allah, talking about winning the war of hearts and minds. And this is one of the occasions in which the enemies of Allah speak the truth, because that's exactly what it is. You know, there's a hadith of the Prophet, in which he is reported to have said, "Al-jihad al-akbar al-jihad al-nafs." You know, the great struggle is the struggle of the nafs. I'm going to share a thought with you. I was reading, in fact, in this book right here, a translation of Sahih al-Bukhari. And I noticed that in the translation of a particular hadith that the translator, may Allah have mercy on him, with good intentions, I'm sure, and I'm sure he's a great scholar of Islam. A great scholar of Islam and a great scholar of Hadith, but he's obviously not a good scholar of English, because he translated the word jihad. He got his understanding or his translation of the word jihad from the enemies of Islam. Their translation of the word jihad. You know, we often hear the word jihad translated as holy war. And this is the mistake the brother made here, because jihad does not mean holy war. It's not what it means. And in fact, what's ridiculous about that is that there is no concept of holy war in Islam. This is a Christian concept. This came out of Christian Europe when they decided to do the Crusades, this concept of holy war. In fact, the word for war in Arabic is harb. Harb is a war. That's when you do fighting and killing. It's in a harb. But there's, you know, smaller wars. But the word jihad means to struggle. And this is when the hadith makes sense. When the Prophet ﷺ said, "Jihad al-Akbar, jihad al-Nafs." Well, if it meant war, especially holy war, like you, in the concept, this holy war concept, like going out and killing people in the name of God, you wouldn't kill yourself in the name of God, right? So this is not what jihad means. Jihad means to struggle. And in every context of the word it used, it means to struggle. To struggle with yourself is jihad al-Akbar, to control your nafs. And I will share with you, brothers, the greatest tool that each individual has in da'wah is jihad al-nafs. The greatest tool is jihad al-nafs. Because it is through your controlling of your lower self that makes you able to set a great example. And when you can set a good example, when you speak Allah's truth, which comes from Allah and His Prophet, when you speak Allah's truth, it's easily received. But it's not received by people who set a bad example. So with that thought, let us seek Allah's forgiveness for our shortcomings and our sins. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم I seek refuge with Allah from misleading and being misled, from betraying and being betrayed into ignorance by others, and I ask Allah to guide my heart and guide my tongue, and to make what I'm about to share with you beneficial. And I pray that Allah helps this message to be not only beneficial, but for you to carry this message to others. I want to share a thought. Something that I become more increasingly aware of the more I listen to, I should say, conversations of the people outside of the Muslim community. And one of the things that I find really interesting and fascinating is this constant attack on one of Allah's greatest mercies. You know, the enemies of Islam in this environment keep speaking against Sharia. They talk about Sharia as if Sharia is a harmful thing. I want you to remind brothers and sisters the true essence of what Sharia is. And let's first start with talking about what the word Sharia means. The word Sharia literally means the path that leads to water. That's literally what it means. From the ancient Arabic, the path that leads to water. Now think about a people who live in a desert environment, and one of the most limited and most important commodities that there is water. What's more important than the path that leads to water? Now let's talk about the meaning of Sharia in a religious context. When we talk about Sharia, in essence, what we're talking about is the path that leads to Jannah. And in essence, what Sharia is, and it's funny they translate Sharia, Islamic law, when in essence, from a religious standpoint, it literally means Islamic law. You don't need the word law. It's like it's being redundant to say Sharia law. Sharia is the law. Sharia, in essence, is the limits set by Allah. It is the punishments set by Allah. It is, when I say limits, Sharia defines the rights of the people. In fact, before Sharia, what Americans, for example, look to as the Constitution and stuff like that, much of what they have in the Constitution, by the way, so you know, if in case you don't know, the founding fathers of this country, a lot of these guys, they studied Islam. Most of these guys were students of Islam. They were scholarly people. And much of what they put in their constitution, they took from Sharia. They learned it from Sharia. Some things they took from the contracts of the Cherokee people. This whole concept of, I don't want to get too deep in it, let me just say this. The reality is, Sharia is a protection of the rights of the people, whether they're Muslim or non-Muslim, whether they're male or whether they're female. Sharia is what protects from dhulm. It is what keeps us from going to excessive, to exceeding the bounds of righteousness. It's what keeps us in just doing justice. It's what keeps us balanced. And I'll point out something to you. In the early days of Islam, in all the time that passed, there was no Sharia. Sharia was not practiced. The Prophet, peace be upon him, and the revelations from Allah did nothing but serve to strengthen the people's iman and get them ready for Sharia. And after they established Medina, this is when Allah began to send down the ayahs, when they established the bay'ah, the oath of allegiance, and established a formal community. This is when Allah began to send down the ayahs of law, putting limits how many women you can marry. What's the punishment for stealing? All of the main things that the enemies of Islam wanted to point out about Sharia is the punishments for adultery, right? The punishments for adultery, you know, which we know, those of us who study the Quran and Sunnah, is execution. This is so extreme, it's such a horrible thing, right? The punishment for an unrepentant thief. It's not the first time he commits an offense, but an unrepentant thief, somebody's a habitual criminal, is to take off a hand. This is just this examples of sharing. This stuff is so frightening. But let's keep in mind this. First of all, unless you have the oath of allegiance in place, you got no business practicing Sharia. Unless you have the institutions that protect the rights of the people, you have no business punishing the people for a crime. For example, you wouldn't punish a person for stealing if he had no access to sadaqah or zakat. Would you? Would you punish him for stealing? If you did, you have no wisdom. Because this person has rights over you. Let me read this ayah from Quran, and I'm digressing too much. Let me read this ayah from Quran. And it's one simple ayah. Covers so much truth that is to be shared with those who do not know. And we should all memorize this ayah, and we should preach it. Qala Allah Ta'ala fil Quran, ba'a'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Laysa al-birra an tuwallu wujuhakum qibal al-mashriqi wal-maghribi walakin al-birra من آمن بالله واليوم الآخر والملائكة والكتاب والنبيين وآتى المال على حبه ذلوا القربى واليتامى والمساكين وابن السبيل والسائلين وفي الرقاب وأقام الصلاة وآتى الزكاة والموفون بأهديهم إذا أهدوا والصابرين في البأساء والضراء وحين البأس أولئك الذين صدقوا وأولئك هم المتقون.
In translation, it is not righteousness that you turn your faces towards the east or the west, but it is righteousness to believe in Allah, and the last day, and the angels, and the book, and the messengers, and to spend out of your substance, out of love for Him, for those who are relatives, for the orphans, for the needy, for the traveler, for those who ask, and for the ransom of slaves. To be steadfast in prayer, to be steadfast in prayer, and to pay the zakat, or the poor tax, or the poor due. To fulfill the contracts which you have made, and to be firm and patient in pain and suffering and adversity, and throughout all periods of panic. Such are the people of the truth, the God-fearing. Such are the people who fear Allah. And again, just real quickly, I want to point out a couple of things about this verse. And when Allah tells us what righteousness is, righteousness begins with proper belief. Worshipping Allah and Him alone. It's through the worship of Allah and Him alone and what follows. What He follows with is to believe in the last day, Yawm al-Akhir. So again, the worship of Allah with a pure worship, and to believe that you're going to be returned to Him on the day of judgment, the last day, and be rewarded or punished. This is the beginning of righteousness, to believe in these things. And to believe in the unseen, believe in the whispering of the jinn, that we cannot see, who are constantly whispering to us to do evil, encouraging us to do evil. And the belief in the angels who are writing down our deeds. And to believe in the book, which is the criterion to judge between right, what is right and what is wrong. The Quran that He sent down, and the previous books in their pure states. And to believe in all of the prophets, from Adam to Abraham, Musa, Dawud alayhi salam, Isa, Jesus, peace be upon him, all the way to the seal of the prophets Muhammad. To believe in all of these things. And after that, the evidence of our belief. To spend out of what Allah has provided for love of Allah, for your relatives, for the orphans, for the needy, for the wayfarer. For those who ask, and I'm going to stop here and make a point. And for the ransom of slaves. Again, and for the ransom of slaves. You know, one of the attacks that the enemies of Islam do use to mislead people from the path of Allah, and to make them think that Islam is corrupt somehow. As they say, you know, in Islam, it's lawful to have slaves. Let me share this thought. During the time of the Prophet, it was lawful to have slaves everywhere in the world. And in fact, even in today's world, where it is unlawful in most environments, slavery exists. I can assure you, brothers and sisters, if you want, challenge me and I will show you right here in Indianapolis, where there are lots of slaves. Slavery still exists. But during the time of the Prophet, slavery was a very common thing. And it's true, Allah did not send down one single ayah that forbids slavery. Not one ayah. And there's not a single hadith of the Prophet that forbids slavery. This is true. But when they tell you that Sharia is corrupt because it allows slavery, let me point this out to you. Throughout the Quran, Allah keeps referencing expiation.